Assalamu alaikum. Good morning, everybody. Today we'll have the last lecture in the cardiovascular physiology, which is the regulation of blood pressure. The objectives of this lecture are to discuss the role of cardiovascular center in the regulation of blood pressure, discuss the neural, hormonal, and autoregulation of blood pressure and blood flow, define the terms pulse, systolic pressure, diastolic pressure, pulse pressure, and the mean arterial pressure, and discuss the physiological variations in blood pressure. As we already know from the previous lecture, that the mean arterial pressure can be estimated either by adding the one-third of the pulse pressure to the diastolic blood pressure, or by multiplying the cardiac output by the total peripheral resistance. Several interconnected negative feedback systems control blood pressure by adjusting the heart rate, the stroke volume, because cardiac output is the product of heart rate and stroke volume. So if we change any one of these, we can also affect the cardiac output as well as the mean arterial pressure. And also by adjusting the total peripheral resistance, because the mean arterial pressure is the product of cardiac output and total peripheral resistance. Another factor that can affect the blood pressure is the blood volume. Some systems allow rapid adjustments, which is short term, to cope with sudden changes, and other systems act more slowly to provide long-term regulation of blood pressure. So we have short-term regulation of blood pressure, and we have long-term regulation or control of blood pressure. As you remember, we studied this slide in one of the previous lectures. The cardiovascular center is present in the medulla oblongata. It receives input from the higher brain centers like the cerebral cortex, the limbic system, and the hypothalamus, and also input from the proprioceptors in the joints and muscles to monitor the movement of the joints, as well as from the baroreceptors that are present in the major blood vessels, and from chemoreceptors, the central and the peripheral chemoreceptors, that we will study more in the respiratory system. The input to the cardiovascular center will be processed in the medulla, then the output will go to the heart or the effector organ, which is the heart and blood vessels. So if the output goes through the vagus nerve, it will reach the heart and it will decrease the heart rate. Output through the sympathetic fibers, the cardiac accelerator nerves, will increase the heart rate and contractility. Sympathetic output to the blood vessels will cause vasoconstriction. So if you notice that sympathetic nervous system will increase the heart rate, will increase the stroke volume, and will cause vasoconstriction. So all of these will increase the mean arterial pressure. So the cardiovascular center is a group of neurons located in the medulla oblongata and helps regulate heart rate, stroke volume, and the total peripheral resistance. It also controls neural, hormonal, and local negative feedback systems that regulate blood pressure and blood flow to specific tissues. The cardiovascular center has different areas or subcenters. These are the cardiostimulatory center. It has neurons that stimulate the heart. The cardioinhibitory center has neurons that inhibit the heart. And the vasomotor center has neurons that control blood vessel diameters by causing constriction or vasoconstriction. And the center, or the vasomotor center, is divided into vasoconstriction center and vasodilator center. So if we need vasoconstriction, the vasoconstriction center will be active, and if we need vasodilation to reduce the total peripheral resistance, then the vasodilator center will be activated. The cardiovascular center receives input from both higher brain regions, as we saw in the previous slides, like the cerebral cortex, the limbic system, and the hypothalamus, and from the sensory receptors, as we said, the proprioceptors, the baroreceptors, and the central as well as the peripheral chemoreceptors. The three main types of sensory receptors that send input to the cardiovascular center, as I said, are the proprioceptors that monitor movements of the joints and skeletal muscles to provide input during the physical activity. They provide rapid increase in heart rate at the beginning of exercise. Baroreceptors, they monitor pressure changes and stretch in the blood vessel wall due to the flow of the blood. Chemoreceptors, these receptors, either peripheral or central, they monitor concentration of various chemicals like carbon dioxide, oxygen, and hydrogen in the blood. And we'll discuss the chemoreceptors in more details in the respiratory center, inshallah. The autonomic innervation of the heart and the baroreceptor reflex. One of the main regulators of the blood pressure is the baroreceptor reflex, or the baroreceptor reflexes. Here in this figure, we have the baroreceptors present in the carotid sinus, the proximal part of the internal carotid artery, and also baroreceptors in the arch of the aorta. The blood flow or stretch in the wall of these baroreceptors that sense mechanical stimuli will send input to the cardiovascular center through the vagus and the glossopharyngeal nerves to the cardiovascular center in the medulla oblongata. The input will be processed, and then the signals will be sent through the motor fibers of the autonomic nervous system to reach the heart, the SA node and the AV node, as well as the ventricular myocardium. So output from the cardiovascular center flows along the sympathetic and parasympathetic neurons of the autonomic nervous system. The parasympathetic outflow to the heart will decrease the heart rate. As I said previously, the parasympathetic system has no role on contractility. It has no role on the force of contraction. The sympathetic outflow to the heart through the cardiac accelerator nerves will increase the heart rate and also increase the contractility, because the sympathetic fibers also supply or innervate the myocardium of both ventricles. Sympathetic outflow to the blood vessels through the vasomotor nerves will cause vasoconstriction. So these are the effects of the cardiovascular center. The vasomotor region of the cardiovascular center continually sends impulses to the arterioles throughout the body, and this will maintain the blood vessels in a moderate state of vasoconstriction. And this is what we explained previously, the sympathetic tone or the vasomotor tone. So it sets the resting level of systemic vascular resistance. So even if you are sitting at rest, not doing any exercise, there is resting level of some degree of vasoconstriction, and this is responsible for the resting level of the systemic vascular resistance. Now, what are the factors that regulate blood pressure and blood flow, which is the main topic of today's lecture? We have at least three main factors. These are the neural regulation, hormonal regulation, and autoregulation. We touched the autoregulation concept a little bit in the previous lecture. The neural regulation of blood pressure, as I said, the nervous system regulates blood pressure via negative feedback loops that occur as two types of reflexes. the baroreflex or the baroreceptor reflex and the chemoreceptor reflex. The baroreceptor reflex or reflexes, where baroreceptors are the pressure sensitive receptors located in the aorta and in the internal carotid arteries or the proximal part of the internal carotid arteries, which is called the carotid sinus. They send impulses to the cardiovascular center to help regulate blood pressure. Two most important baroreceptor reflexes are the carotid sinus reflex, where the carotid baroreflex baroreceptors are stimulated. This helps regulate blood pressure in the brain. The other baroreceptor reflex is the aortic reflex. It regulates systemic blood pressure because the baroreceptors are present in the arch of the aorta. When blood pressure falls, the baroreceptors are stretched to less extent, or the stretch on the baroreceptors will decrease. This will lead to slower rate of impulses or less frequent action potential delivery to the cardiovascular center. There, in the cardiovascular center, the information will be processed, and this will lead to decreased parasympathetic stimulation and increased sympathetic stimulation. The result will be an increase in the heart rate, an increase in the stroke volume, and an increase in the systemic vascular resistance. And we know that the mean arterial pressure depend or is the product of multiplying these three variables. And so eventually, the blood pressure will increase back to normal, and this is a very good example of negative feedback system that we explained in the introduction lecture. So the stimulus was a decrease in blood pressure. The response is an increase in blood pressure back to normal. I think you remember this slide from the introduction lecture when we spoke about the negative feedback system, and we gave the regulation of blood pressure as a good example of negative feedback system. I will explain briefly here. I said that a decrease in the blood pressure will stimulate the baroreceptors, or to lesser extent the baroreceptors in the aorta and the carotid sinus. So this will lead to decreased rate of frequency of nerve impulses that are sent to the control center in the medulla oblongata, and this eventually will send motor output through the sympathetic fibers, where the sympathetic activity will increase and the parasympathetic activity will decrease. And also there are impulses that will reach the adrenal medulla through the sympathetic fibers to stimulate the adrenal medulla to release epinephrine and norepinephrine. All of these will act on the effectors. And these are the heart, where there will be an increased stroke volume and increased heart rate, and this will increase the cardiac output. The other effector are the smooth muscle cells present in the arterioles, so this will increase the systemic vascular resistance, and this eventually will increase the blood pressure back to normal. As I said previously, we have two main locations for the baroreceptors: the carotid sinus baroreceptors present in the carotid sinus, the proximal portion of the internal carotid artery, and we have the aortic arch baroreceptors that are present in the arch of the aorta. Now, the second sensory receptors that are important for the regulation of blood pressure are the chemoreceptors. Chemoreceptors are sensory receptors that monitor the chemical composition of blood and are located close to the baroreceptors of the carotid sinus and the aortic arch, in small structures called the carotid bodies and aortic bodies. So the chemoreceptors are present in the form of small collection of cells called the carotid bodies and the aortic bodies, respectively, at the bifurcation of the common carotid artery and in the aortic arch, respectively. The chemoreceptors detect changes in blood levels of oxygen, carbon dioxide, and hydrogen. Here we are talking about the peripheral chemoreceptors, and also in the respiratory system we will speak or will explain in details the central chemoreceptors that are present in the medulla oblongata. Chemoreceptors are stimulated by hypoxia, hypercapnia, and acidosis. So the stimulus for the chemoreceptors, or the stimuli for chemoreceptors, are low oxygen, high carbon dioxide, and high hydrogen. And these stimuli will act on the chemoreceptors. This will lead to sending signals to the cardiovascular center. The cardiovascular center increases sympathetic stimulation to the arterioles and veins, producing vasoconstriction and an increase in the blood pressure. These chemoreceptors also provide input to the respiratory center in the brainstem to adjust the respiratory rate or the pulmonary ventilation rate or also the breathing rate. So the chemoreceptors are important for the regulation of breathing as well as the regulation of the blood pressure. The hormonal regulation of blood pressure is via several hormones. Several hormones help regulate blood pressure and blood flow by changing the cardiac output or stroke volume or adjusting the blood volume. So hormones can affect the cardiac output, the systemic vascular resistance, and blood volume. These hormones are renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system, RAAS, which is the abbreviation for that system, epinephrine and norepinephrine from the adrenal medulla, antidiuretic hormone from the posterior pituitary gland. You will study this hormone in details in the renal system and in the endocrine system, and the atrial natriuretic peptide, AMP, that is released from the wall of the atria if the wall of the atria is overstretched by high blood volume. So let's talk about renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system, and you will encounter this slide in many lectures in the endocrine system as well as in the urinary system. Here you can see the stimulus for the renin angiotensin, or the trigger for the renin angiotensin aldosterone system, is dehydration or low sodium or low blood volume due to hemorrhage, the severe blood loss. This will lead to decrease in blood volume, and the decrease in blood volume causes a decrease in the blood pressure. The kidneys or special cells in the kidneys will sense this low blood pressure. These cells are called juxtaglomerular cells, cells present near the glomeruli in the kidney. These cells, when they sense low blood pressure, they will release a hormone called renin. Renin will convert protein or plasma protein, an inactive plasma protein called angiotensinogen, that is produced by the liver. The action of renin on this inactive plasma protein, angiotensinogen, will convert it into angiotensin 1. Angiotensin 1 has low activity, so it should be activated to stronger chemical substance, angiotensin 2, and this happens when the blood passes through the pulmonary circulation, where the endothelial cells in the pulmonary circulation have a plasma membrane protein called angiotensin converting enzyme. So as blood that contains angiotensin 1 passes through the lungs or into the pulmonary circulation, the enzyme angiotensin converting enzyme will convert angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2, which is a very active vasoactive substance. This angiotensin 2 will cause vasoconstriction of the arterioles. So this will increase the systemic vascular resistance and will increase the blood pressure back to normal. Another effect or another action of angiotensin 2, that it stimulates the adrenal cortex, the outer layer of the adrenal gland that is present above each kidney. The stimulation of adrenal cortex by angiotensin 2 will increase the release of aldosterone from the adrenal cortex. Aldosterone in the kidneys will increase sodium and water reabsorption. So aldosterone will try to keep sodium and water inside the body to increase the blood volume. And if we increase the blood volume, we can increase the blood pressure back to normal. Also, aldosterone will increase the secretion of potassium and hydrogen in urine. So it will remove potassium and hydrogen from our body. Epinephrine and norepinephrine, the other set of hormones important in the hormonal regulation of blood pressure. In response to sympathetic stimulation, the adrenal medulla releases epinephrine and norepinephrine, but mainly it releases epinephrine. These two hormones increase cardiac output by increasing the heart rate and the force of contraction. So this eventually will increase the cardiac output. Increases in heart rate and stroke volume will increase the cardiac output and blood. The third set of hormones is the antidiuretic hormone that is also called vasopressin because it is has vasopressor effect on the blood vessels, or it causes vasoconstriction. Dehydration or low blood volume will increase antidiuretic hormone release from the posterior pituitary gland, and this antidiuretic hormone will decrease urine output. It will stimulate the kidneys to retain water inside the body, so urine formation will decrease and the retention of water will increase the blood volume. An increase in blood volume will increase the blood pressure. Also, vasopressin, from its name, it causes vasoconstriction, so it increases the systemic vascular resistance or the total peripheral resistance. Systemic vascular resistance is equal to the total peripheral resistance. They have the same meaning. So as we see here in this part of the figure, there is the stimuli for antidiuretic hormone release are high blood osmotic pressure due to dehydration, or high blood pressure due to dehydration. This will stimulate the hypothalamic osmoreceptors, special receptors that sense changes in the osmolarity. Osmoreceptors will activate neurosecretory cells that produce and release antidiuretic hormone. The nerve impulses from those neurons or neurosecretory cells will travel down the posterior to their terminals in the posterior pituitary gland, where the antidiuretic hormone will be released. Antidiuretic hormone release or released antidiuretic hormone will circulate in the blood. It will act on the kidneys to stimulate water retention and decrease urine output, and this will increase the blood volume. Also, it will decrease sweating or water loss from the skin and will cause vasoconstriction or will constrict the blood vessels, and therefore will increase the systemic vascular resistance, and eventually all of these, the increase in blood volume and the vasoconstriction, will increase blood pressure back to normal. The low blood osmotic pressure after the retention of water will inhibit the hypothalamic receptors, and the inhibition of the hypothalamic receptors will reduce antidiuretic hormone secretion, and this will stop the negative feedback loop. The other hormone, or the last hormone that affect the blood pressure, is AMP. It is a peptide hormone that is released by cells in the atria of the heart when the atria are stretched by increased blood volume. It causes vasodilation, and this will decrease the total peripheral resistance and decrease the blood pressure. It increases the loss of sodium and water in the urine. From the name, natriuresis means loss of sodium in urine. And we know very well that water follows sodium. So if sodium is less lost in urine, water also will be lost in urine. And the loss of water will decrease the blood volume and will decrease the venous return, which will decrease the cardiac output and eventually will decrease the blood pressure. So AMP effect is opposite to the previous three sets of hormones or three regulatory mechanisms. Both effects, which is vasodilation and the reduction of blood volume, reduce the blood pressure. So AMP final effect is reduction of the blood pressure. Here we can see summary of the different factors that affect the blood pressure, or the different hormones that affect the blood pressure. There are hormones that affect the cardiac output, so like epinephrine and norepinephrine, both will increase the heart rate and contractility, and this will lead to an increase in the blood pressure. Hormones that act on the blood vessels and cause vasoconstriction are angiotensin II, antidiuretic hormone or vasopressin, norepinephrine, and epinephrine. So they will increase the systemic vascular resistance, and they eventually will increase the blood pressure. Hormones that cause vasodilation and decrease blood pressure are AMP, epinephrine in certain circulatory beds that you'll study in details later on, and nitric oxide. There are hormones that affect the blood volume, so they can regulate or control blood pressure by changing the blood volume. Hormones that increase blood volume are aldosterone and antidiuretic hormone, and these two hormones will increase the blood pressure. Hormones that decrease the blood volume is one hormone, which is AMP. The reduction of blood volume will decrease the blood pressure. Now let's talk about the third regulatory mechanism. We spoke about the neural control of blood pressure, the hormonal control of the blood pressure, and now let's talk about the autoregulation of blood flow. As I explained in the previous lecture, autoregulation is the ability of a tissue to automatically adjust its blood flow to match its metabolic demands. Local blood flow is regulated independent of the blood pressure. I mentioned that in the previous lecture. In each capillary bed, local changes regulate vasomotion, or the state of contraction of the blood vessel wall. So contraction and relaxation of smooth muscle of the meta-arterioles that are present just distal to the arterioles and the pre-capillary sphincters. There are two types of stimuli that cause autoregulatory changes in blood flow: the physical changes, as well as vasodilating and vasoconstricting chemicals. If you remember in the previous lecture, we said physical changes in the form of myogenic tone, as well as other factors like temperature, and the vasodilating and vasoconstricting chemicals, and these were covered under local metabolites or metabolic response. Let's discuss first the physical changes and how they affect the, or how they mediate the autoregulatory mechanism. Number one, warming or increase in the temperature of certain part of the body will cause vasodilation in the blood vessels supplying that part, and this will increase the blood flow to that part or that organ of the body. On the other hand, cooling or low temperature or decrease in the temperature of any part in the body will cause vasoconstriction in the blood vessels supplying that part, and this will reduce the blood flow to that organ or that part. In addition to the temperature, the myogenic response of smooth muscles in the walls of the arterioles is also part of the autoregulatory mechanism. The smooth muscles contract more forcibly when stretched suddenly and relax when the stretch lessens again suddenly. So sudden change in the stretch degree, either increase or decrease, will cause contraction and relaxation of the smooth muscles. Example, blood flow through an arteriole decreases, or when there is sudden decrease in blood flow in an arteriole, so this will cause sudden release and the stretch on the arteriolar wall, so the smooth muscles will relax, and this will lead to vasodilation, and the decrease in vasodilation will cause an increase in blood flow. So this is an example of negative feedback, where the stimulus is a decrease in blood flow and the response is an increase in blood flow back to normal. Vasodilating and vasoconstricting chemicals that mediate the autoregulatory mechanism, white blood cells, platelets, smooth muscle fibers, macrophages and endothelial cells release a wide variety of chemicals that alter or change the blood vessel diameter. Vasodilators that are released from cells and tissues are potassium, hydrogen, lactic acid or lactate, adenosine, nitric oxide, kinines, and histamine. Vasoconstrictors are thromboxane A2, superoxide radicals, serotonin, and endothelin. Different autoregulatory effects of oxygen in the systemic and pulmonary circulation, and I mentioned that in the previous lecture, and I'm repeating this piece of information here just to stress on its importance. An important difference between pulmonary and systemic circulations is their autoregulatory response to changes in oxygen level. Systemic blood vessels dilate in response to low oxygen to increase the oxygen delivery to the tissues. What, on the other hand, pulmonary blood vessels constrict under low oxygen to ensure that blood mostly bypasses poorly ventilated alveoli in the lungs and most blood flows to better ventilated areas of the lung, so to ensure that blood is well oxygenated as it passes into or through the lungs. How to check the circulation? The physician can check the circulation by checking several things. One of them is pulse. The pulse is the alternate expansion and recoil of the elastic arteries after each left ventricular systole creates a traveling pressure wave that is called pulse. It is strongest in the arteries that are very close to the heart and can be felt in an artery that lies near the surface of the body that can be compressed against bone or other firm structures. And examples are the brachial pulse, the radial pulse that you have learned in anatomy. The normal pulse rate reflects the normal heart rate, and it is between 60 and 100 beats per minute. Tachycardia is a pulse rate or heart rate of more than 100 beats per minute at rest, while bradycardia is a pulse rate or heart rate less than 60 beats per minute at rest. In terms of blood pressure, blood pressure is defined as the force exerted by the blood on the arterial walls. Systolic blood pressure is the maximal pressure exerted by the blood on the arterial walls during ventricular systole. Diastolic blood pressure is the minimal pressure exerted by the blood on the arterial walls during ventricular diastole. Blood pressure is clinically expressed as systolic blood pressure by diastolic blood pressure, for example 120 over 80 millimeter mercury. The pulse pressure, there is something called pulse pressure, and it is different from blood pressure. Please be careful when you use the terms in describing things. Pulse pressure is the difference between the systolic and diastolic blood pressures. So the pulse pressure is equal to systolic blood pressure minus diastolic blood pressure. And in our previous example, 120 minus 80 millimeter mercury, and the result is 40 millimeter mercury. So the pulse pressure, if the blood pressure is 120 over 80, then the pulse pressure is 40. The mean arterial pressure is the average blood pressure in the arteries throughout the cardiac cycle. And I'm talking about the average pressure in the systemic arteries throughout the cardiac cycle. The mean arterial pressure is equal to diastolic blood pressure plus 1/3 pulse pressure in millimeter mercury. So in our example, it is equal to 80 plus 1/3, 40, which is equal to 93.3 millimeter mercury. Blood pressure exhibits physiological variation depending on gender, age, the body build, and so on. So let's see what is or what are the physiological variations under different conditions. So age, blood pressure is low at birth but increases gradually to reach adult levels at the age of 20 years. It tends to rise with age due to loss of the arterial wall elasticity due to a condition called atherosclerosis. Gender, young women have slightly lower blood pressure compared to young men. However, after the age of 45 years, the diastolic blood pressure in female rises more rapidly in female due to the hormonal changes after the menopause. So the lower blood pressure in female below the age or before menopause is due to their sex hormones, especially estrogen. The body built systolic blood pressure is usually high in the obese people. Why? Because we said obesity is responsible for increasing the total vascular length. And we know that as we increase the total blood vessel length, we are increasing the systemic vascular resistance, and this will increase the mean arterial pressure according to the equation that we had studied earlier. The incidence of pathological hypertension is also higher in obese people compared to those of leaner body build. Other physiological variations in blood pressure are: in exercise, systolic blood pressure increases during muscular exercise. It can go up to 180 millimeter mercury in very strenuous or very severe type of exercise due to the increase in cardiac output. But the blood pressure will decrease back to pre-exercise level during recovery after stopping the exercise. Diastolic blood pressure may remain unchanged or slightly decreases due to the vasodilation of the arterioles in the active skeletal muscles and skin. Emotions. These result in sympathetic stimulation that increases cardiac output and will increase the blood pressure. And sleep. Usually during sleep, the systolic blood pressure falls by 10 to 20 millimeter because the sympathetic activity is low and parasympathetic activity is high during sleep. With this lecture, we finish all the lectures of the cardiovascular physiology. I hope you understood everything about the cardiac cycle, cardiac output, the blood flow, the blood pressure, and the factors that affect the blood pressure and blood flow, as well as the blood flow through specific circulations. Thank you for your audience. I will appreciate any questions by email, and see you in the next lecture, inshallah. Goodbye.